where you see the passing of time.
The crowds in St. Peter's Square are praying like mad for the Pope's life.
Where moments refuse to die.
This is a momentous hour in world history. This is the invasion of Hitler's Europe.
And where victory lives on.
Plenty of girls are being kissed by plenty of boys they don't know, and they do not care.
You can love it, hate it, embrace it, or turn away.
Lenin was shot to death late last night outside his apartment building.
But it is a past we all share.
Come on out here and give me a salute. Big Navy salute.
This is where yesterday has a home, where we wonder what it was like back then.
Go forward, knights, in safety.
And not too long ago.
His spirit must live on.
It's where history has its place and where the past comes alive. The History Channel. It's oft been said that he who rules the waves rules the world. That was certainly true for the bloody years of World War II. For had the battles of the Pacific and Atlantic taken another turn, the world we live in might be a very different place indeed. Europe, 1939. A year when the eyes of the world turned towards once defeated Germany in horrified surprise. Under Führer Adolf Hitler, the Third Reich had been secretly rebuilding her armed forces. And now, in a brazen initiation of war, her land forces were effortlessly decimating European armies. On the high seas, her navy, the Kriegsmarine, seemed unstoppable. And no sea was as critical to the war as the Atlantic.
The Battle of the Atlantic was the most important battle of World War II. If you couldn't get supplies over to keep Britain going, we wouldn't have been able to defeat Nazi Germany. We wouldn't have been able to win the war. So everything, in a certain sense, depended on victory in the Battle of the Atlantic.
2 years into hostilities with the Germans, the British position in the Battle of the Atlantic seemed hopeless. The Germans were destroying up to 800,000 tons of shipping per month, sinking ships faster than the British and Americans could build them. Britain's lifeline was in grave danger of being choked off. Her leaders were secretly worried that defeat was at hand. Winston Churchill himself had dark fears that the mighty German navy would sound the death knell for Great Britain.
Churchill believed that the Battle of the Atlantic was one of the most important parts of Britain's efforts in World War II. He said he was frightened sometime by the number of sinkings and wondered how long Britain could continue into the war.
The Atlantic is home to countless fierce predators, but perhaps none were as ferocious as Germany's dreaded fleet of U-boats. These sleek steel death machines of the open ocean were known as grey wolves. British sub-lieutenant David Baum had encountered grey wolves soon after enlisting in the Royal Navy.
In September 39, I was in a destroyer called the Ivanhoe, one of two destroyers escorting the aircraft carrier Courageous when she was torpedoed and sunk. It was very dramatic, one of the very first actions of the whole war at sea, only 10 days after the war had begun. A big loss of life. Frightful.
The chief architect of Germany's stranglehold on the Atlantic was Admiral Karl Dönitz. As a former submarine commander himself, Dönitz understood the special qualities required of the men who lived their lives gliding silently beneath the waves in these so-called iron coffins. His memoirs reflect his commitment to the war below the surface.
Every submariner, I am sure, has experienced in his heart the glow of the open sea, has felt himself to be as rich as a king, and for change places with no man.
Georg Hogel met Admiral Dönitz as a young sailor in the U-boat command.
Dönitz is to all Zeiten respektiert worden. Vielleicht klingt das jetzt ein bisschen.
Dönitz had always been respected. This might sound a bit sentimental, but the old generation of U-boat sailors have always considered him the father of the U-boat sailors. Dönitz had always had our respect, and this was also true for foreign admirals and generals, who also said he was an excellent leader of his men.
Führer seiner Leute war.
After fighting in World War I, Dönitz studied submarine warfare with single-minded devotion. He extended the same devotion to the men of his Kriegsmarine, becoming a one-man welcoming crew as they returned from training exercises and missions. Short in stature, but a giant to his men, Dönitz was tireless and dedicated to a fault, determined to refine and perfect the merciless German U-boat strategy known as Wolfpack.
The way the Wolfpack strategy worked was as follows. One submarine would spot a convoy and would radio back to headquarters in Germany or occupied France the location of this convoy.
No longer would submarines operate alone and isolated in the vast ocean. Dönitz's men glided beneath the waves until they located the enemy, then waited for reinforcements. When darkness fell over the water, they attacked in a swarm, striking quickly and without pity.
Torpedo! Whoa!
To Dönitz, Wolfpack tactics seemed as much instinct as they did carefully orchestrated strategy.
One of our most natural instincts is the desire, if fight we must, to be as strong as possible, not to be left to fight alone, but to seek the help of others. From time immemorial, therefore, men have always banded themselves together to fight in unison.
The Wolfpacks ran free at the beginning of the war. The pickings in the Atlantic were so easy that the German skippers even gave the era a jaunty nickname.
The Germans called the heyday of the U-boats in 1940 the happy time. They had a field day during this period.
Dönitz and his grey wolves were masters of the seas. Great Britain was bruised, bloodied, and reeling from the German onslaught. Even America's shores weren't immune from the U-boat menace. Heavy shipping losses along the eastern seaboard from U-boat attacks led to near panic. Naval and private vessels alike patrolled the waters, searching for the dreaded Nazi submarines. Dönitz controlled everything from his lavish headquarters in occupied France, issuing a steady stream of instructions and orders to his trusted warriors beneath the waves. For the reign of the Grey Wolves depended on constant communication with Dönitz.
All orders bringing the U-boats together were issued from his headquarters by radio communications. The U-boats constantly reported back their positions, their usages of torpedoes, their fuel, and so forth. And, of course, this created a lot of communications material for the British to lock in on if they managed to break it.
But Dönitz was convinced the Allies could never break his codes because he had a secret weapon, the Enigma machine. Almost all wartime communication on both the Allied and Axis sides was encrypted, but the Enigma was among the most sophisticated of all encryption machines. It was capable of millions of variations and considered unbreakable by the German high command. Using messages kept secret by Enigma, Dönitz could dispatch U-boats to surround British convoys. The British had their top codebreakers working around the clock at an English country estate called Bletchley Park to plumb its secrets. If they didn't solve the riddle of the enigma, they knew the war might be lost.
Churchill looked at a chart at the Admiralty, watching the line of sinkings rising on the wall to a red line which they had drawn across the top, which meant that Britain could not continue the war, and it was rapidly approaching that line.
As the curtain closed on 1940, Britain's fate rose and fell in the most capricious and uncertain of places, the rolling waters of the open ocean. The men of Germany's U-boat fleet roamed the high seas unhindered during the early days of World War II. Their stealth made them a frustratingly elusive target for enemy ships. The U-boats were deadly instruments of power and brought both misery and glory to those who served aboard them. Georg Hogel joined the German Navy in 1937 at the age of 18 and became a U-boat radio operator the following year. He was one of the select young men in Dönitz U-boat service.
The enthusiasm for the U-boats, so to speak, came from a young man's desire to be in a service to which we attributed danger and a certain prestige. We wanted to become men, and therefore we wanted to join a service which was considered to be one of the toughest.
The unprecedented success of the U-boat crews made them heroes at home. Nazi Minister of Propaganda Josef Goebbels lionized the most noted U-boat aces and dubbed them the Grey Wolves. Adolf Hitler himself handed out iron crosses to the most decorated of U-boat skippers.
When we returned home, there was an orchestra at the pier. There were officers, other crews, and maybe even a few young ladies. As sailors on a U-boat, we were maybe aware that we were using one of the most dangerous weapons and that our fight in the Atlantic was necessary to cut the English trade.
With their white peaked caps and astonishing tales of seafaring victories and derring do, these elite young officers and their men were given the privileges of royalty. The best of everything was theirs for the taking.
They were issued the highest medals. They got the best pay. They got the best food. There were films made about them. They were treated as heroes.
We had excellent food, and you might laugh about this, but we always had porcelain on board. The only time we had to eat from a tin plate was when we returned home and there was no more unbroken porcelain available.
Dönitz's emphasis on making heroes of the U-boat aces may have been in part an ingenious strategy to offset the reality of the most arduous and deadly job in the German military.
The U-boat was almost unlivable by the standards of civilians. It was crowded, it was dirty. There was one head for all 47 men, officers and men. It was almost always in use. You couldn't use it when the boat was submerged.
Then, for the ersten Fahrt,
during my first trip, we could hardly wash ourselves. We had to beg for cooling water from the diesel engines so we could at least wash our upper bodies. During this trip, we also made coffee with rusty water or salt water. It was really bad.
You're underwater. You don't get any fresh air. There's water all over dripping down on the side from the condensation. So it's wet, it's clammy, it's damp. You're never dry. You can't take a shower. I mean, it's like a super locker room. There are salamis and other things hanging around. You're always with the same guy. The same songs are being played. There's nothing to do. When U-boat ships came back into port and the land crew opened up the front hatches to let the men out, the stench was so bad that they stepped back.
It took a seaman with a singular dedication and audacity to withstand such grueling conditions and to descend time and again in the iron coffins. from which 2 out of every 3 sailors never returned.
I was always aware of the fact that this boat could be my coffin. I often told some of my comrades in critical situations that it doesn't make any sense to run from one end of the boat to the other. If a torpedo explodes, you will drown anyway. Death comes so fast, I used to say, that you probably won't feel much. Each voyage was different, and each event showed us that we actually did not know anything, and that there were 100 more ways to lose one's life.
One of the courageous stars of Dönitz's U-boat fleet was 28-year-old Fritz Julius Lemp. Lemp had joined the Navy at the age of 18, and in 10 years' time had become the youngest captain in the history of German submarine warfare. Lemp was cautious but aggressive and unflappable in battle. He was known sometimes to give orders just so his men could hear the calm, confident sound of his voice. Georg Hogel served under Lemp on his first mission on the Type 7 sub U-30.
He was an äußerst kameradschaftlicher Kommandant.
He was a very friendly captain. He backed up his men as much as he could, even if they made a blunder. As a radio operator, I was constantly next to him. We were separated only by a little hallway and developed a personal relationship. With his permission, during the times when there was nothing going on, which happened frequently, we could play records for the crew. These were little things, but they made life a little more comfortable and contributed to the camaraderie. Nothing could have worked without that.
Lemp had assured his place in history in the opening days of the war between Germany and Britain while skippering the U-30. Waiting for fighting to begin on September the 3rd, 1939, Dönitz had issued strict orders to his U-boat fleet. They were not to attack passenger ships in observance of the regulations passed by the Hague Convention at the turn of the century.
Enemy convoys to be attacked without warning only on condition that all passenger liners carrying passengers are allowed to proceed in safety. These vessels are immune from attack, even in convoy.
Lurking beneath the waters of the Atlantic at the helm of the U-30, Lemp peered through his periscope and glimpsed a large ship zigzagging in the water. Immediately assuming she was an armed merchant cruiser, Lemp ordered his men to fire torpedoes. The torpedoes struck the hapless ship's port flank dead on.
And he sank the ship. And he came to surface to inspect his handiwork, and he saw that she was not an armed merchant cruiser.
Lemp, overzealous and eager to make his mark in the highly competitive Kriegsmarine, had made a terrible blunder.
And on the first day of the war, Germany begins her mass murder at sea. The survivors of the Athenia land, living witnesses of the horror of Nazi warfare.
The ship he sank was the British luxury liner Athenia, en route from Glasgow to New York with more than 1,300 people aboard. 100 innocents died that day. 28 of the victims were Americans. Lemp's brazen attack pushed an already nervous world that much closer to international warfare. Hitler and his inner circle of Nazi leaders immediately churned out reams of propaganda trying to explain away Lemp's impulsive attack. They claimed the British had sunk their own liner in an underhanded attempt to force the Americans into the war.
Now, when Lemp returned to Germany, he reported sinking Athena, and all hell broke loose because of the propaganda that the Germans had issued before. It was finally decreed that the page of the logbook recording the sinking of Athena was be removed from U-30's log, and another page inserted, which puts the submarine several hundred miles away from the site of the sinking, and the crew were sworn to secrecy.
But Lemp survived this early mistake and was later awarded an Iron Cross by Dönitz, who seemed to have a soft spot for him. By 1941, he was a decorated lieutenant at the helm of the U-110, a new swift and powerful Type 9 attack boat, one of the jewels of the Nazi arsenal. To staff his gleaming new vessel, Lemp requested his best men from the U-30 crew, Georg Hogel among them.
There was nothing more inconvenient for a U-boat crew member than to be separated from his crew. This is why Captain Lemp wanted to keep people on board who had already served under him and had experience.
On May the 9th, 1941, Lemp and the crew of the U-110 were stalking the icy waters off the coast of Greenland when they sighted a mammoth British convoy. Here was another opportunity for Lemp to enhance his reputation and deal another blow to the British Empire. It was just another day at war, just another convoy. Lemp couldn't have known that on that sunny day in 1941, he was about to become a pivotal player in one of the Atlantic's most titanic struggles. Meanwhile, aboard British convoy OB-318, this routine journey to America to gather raw materials for the war effort seemed to be proceeding smoothly. Even officers like Sub-Lieutenant David Barnes, stationed on the escort destroyer HMS Bulldog, had no sense of the danger that lay ahead.
It was a fine day. I think there was some quite sunny blue skies, big swell, as you always get in the Atlantic. It was about noon. I was standing on the bridge.
Bulldog was just one of the 38 ships in the convoy procession, plodding through the waves at a deliberate pace.
Some of these ships are very old, and they'd only go at about 8 knots. So the speed of this convoy would be about 8 knots, incredibly so.
To the wolves waiting beneath the waves, these lumbering vessels appeared easy prey indeed. Through his periscope, Fritz Julius Lemp sighted his quarry and decided to attack.
Torpedo! Fire, fire!
Two British merchant ships exploded and disappeared beneath the waves.
Terrific explosion, of course, two of our merchant ships being hit. And they sink very quickly, these merchant ships, matter of minutes.
David Barnes' commanding officer, A.J. Baker Cresswell, heard the explosions from his position on the Bulldog's bridge.
Baker Cresswell suddenly saw a giant column of water rise up from the side of a ship, and realized that he was suddenly under attack.
Baker Cresswell, Balm, and the crewmen on the British escorts burned with rage. To face open combat at sea was one thing, but to be attacked by stealth by this invisible foe was an act of audacity that cried out for revenge.
We dashed over to a direction we thought the submarine must be and attacked with depth charges.
The depth charges launched by the British were set at the perfect range, and the U-110's escape was cut off. Mortally wounded, she staggered deeper into the black depths of the freezing Atlantic.
The explosion was so strong that we thought it was over. You were in a cage for which there was no escape.
It's almost slit there.
Lemp was faced with a terrible decision. If he let the boat sink, he and his crew of 45 men would surely die as the implacable ocean's pressure crushed the submarine. If they surfaced, the British would likely kill them and capture the boat. And the U-110, like all German U-boats, carried an Enigma machine. The centerpiece of Dönitz's strategy to win the Battle of the Atlantic. To surrender the Enigma and the Nazis' secret codes would be to give the Allies a key weapon they needed to turn the tide against Hitler. The depth charges continued to explode around the U-110, adding to the confusion and panic. The stricken boat sunk further. Lemp, torn between the sense of duty and honor drilled into him by Dönitz and the instinct for survival, agonized while his men waited silently for his orders. He had only a few more seconds to make a decision that would perhaps alter the course of World War II. May the 9th, 1941, had dawned uncharacteristically bright and clear in the chilly North Atlantic. But the day had turned dark for German U-boat captain Fritz Julius Lemp and his men aboard the U-110. They had just sunk two merchant ships in a convoy returning from Great Britain, but depth charges had mortally wounded their submarine. Lemp had spent nearly half his life at sea. He'd matched wits with the best the ocean had to offer and been victorious each time. But he'd never faced certain death as surely as he did that afternoon, as his U-boat hung lifelessly in the Atlantic. The ocean's pressure squeezed the boat's hull, causing floor plates that normally sat flush to buckle and overlap. Lemp realized that if he didn't surface, he and all of his men would perish beneath the waves.
The U-boat crews knew that their chances of surviving were quite difficult if they came under fire. They would be below the surface, there'd be the depth charging, they would be blown to the surface, they might get out if they were lucky. If not, they would be trapped, they would never get out.
Lemp gathered himself, and in the calm voice his crew had come to expect, no matter how exultant or grave the situation, gave the order to surface. He was giving up instead of going down. He blew the ballast tanks, and the U-110 rocketed up from the depths of the Atlantic.
And the only time they realize that they've hit the surface is when they feel the swell of the ocean banging against the sides of the submarine.
Lemp gave orders for scuttling charges to be set, then told his men to abandon ship.
Rouse, rouse, rouse!
The British sailors aboard the Bulldog watched in disbelief as the U-110 broke the surface near their destroyer.
Baker Creswell saw this, and he was furious. I mean, the submarine is regarded very often as an underhanded form of warfare. It's underground, it's sneaky, all of that kind of stuff. And he was going to go for this boat and ram it.
The U-110 bobbed helplessly on the ocean's surface. Baker Creswell, David Baum, and the rest of the Bulldog crew were face to face with their formerly invisible nemesis. Baker Creswell prepared to drive the prow of his ship through the monstrous Nazi war machine.
Lemp went to check out the situation. The first thing he said was, "Ships, ships, ships." My station chief asked him about the classified material, and he told us to leave everything on the boat. The only thing he said was, "Get out, get out, we are being rammed."
But as the British commander watched the crew of the U-110 leaping into the water, he realized he had a rare chance to seize a German sub.
He thought to himself, "Maybe I can get the code books." Instead of ramming the U-110, he said, full astern, the ship came shuddering to a halt, and he sent over a boarding party.
Sub-Lieutenant David Baum was charged with leading the boarding party. Time was of the essence, since the British assumed the evacuating Germans had activated scuttling charges to sink their own vessel. A tiny rowboat dropped over the side of the Bulldog, and Baum and eight men cautiously made their way towards the Grey Wolf. They knew it was possible the submarine could blow up beneath them at any second. Baum and his crew were facing a peril they'd never encountered before.
We took our rowing boat alongside the hull, jumped on board. I had my revolver in my hand.
As David Baum climbed aboard the U-110, the members of her crew struggled to stay afloat in the swells of the Atlantic. They had completely abandoned the surfaced submarine. Some of the crew had been killed in crossfire from the British destroyers, others drowned in the sea. 32 others were snatched from the water and hustled below decks on the British ships.
I was among the last eight people who left the boat. I jumped from the bridge onto the deck. Since the stern was already underwater, I ran to the tower, to the front of the boat. When I reached the cannon, a large wave swept over the boat. I first held on and then let go.
But what of the U-110's fearless commander, Fritz Julius Lemp? Some witnesses claim that when he saw that the scuttling charges hadn't fired, he swam back towards his submarine, determined to sink it himself before it fell into enemy hands. The truth is still unknown, whether he drowned in the attempt or was shot down by British gunfire.
Captain Lemp was on the tower and helped everybody to get out of the boat. I was swimming in another direction. I couldn't see what happened to him. The only thing I know is that we never saw him again.
And as the gentle swells of the Atlantic washed over her, a different officer now strode the deck of the U-110.
And I then walked along the deck of the U-boat, which is a pretty slippery thing, with water breaking over it. But then I came to the ladder going up to the conning tower, and I had to holster my revolver, use both hands to go up a vertical ladder.
Baum made his way down the U-110's conning tower as his men waited anxiously on the deck. He still didn't know what dangers awaited him below.
I opened up the hatch, going down below, and this was the worst moment of the whole day. That I might say the worst moment of my life. Opening up that hatch, seeing nobody down below, but then thinking there must be somebody down below.
Baum descended into the captured U-110. He couldn't have been more vulnerable to a waiting enemy intent upon revenge or ambush.
I had to holster my revolver and go down this vertical ladder of about 15 feet, wondering if there was somebody down below who would have certainly shot me if I'd arrived.
But there was no armed enemy sailor awaiting Baum in the cabin of the U-110. The boat was desolate.
I arrived down at the bottom, in the control room of this U-boat. And the secondary lighting was on, dim lighting, and there was that deathly silence. Just the plopping of the waves against our hull, but nobody there. I quickly went from one end of the U-boat to the other, and still nobody there. So I then called down my boarding party to come and join me.
Still in a race against the expected explosion of German scuttling charges, Baum and his men canvassed their captured trophy from bow to stern.
We obviously wanted to find all the code books and charts and everything like that. We're only eight of us, but we made a chain. We sent up every book, except for obviously reading books. I had a telegraphist in my boarding party. His job was immediately to go to the wireless office and take the settings and all the sets. And he came along to me and said, "Would you like to come see something in the wireless office?" We didn't know what it was. It just looked like a typewriter.
Baum and his crewmen tried the keys on this typewriter, and something strange happened.
If you punched in, say, for example, the letter A, it may come out as a Z. However, next time you punch the letter A, it may come out as an N or something else.
Baum and his crew had discovered the German secret weapon, a key to the success of their underwater war strategy. It was the Enigma machine itself, the encryption device that kept the secrets of the U-boats from the Allies. In their race to save themselves, the German crew had left behind not only the device itself, but the code books, rotor settings, and a grid map marking the sectors for all of Germany's U-boats in the Atlantic. They had surrendered a virtual handbook of their secret communications system to the British. It was a remarkable capture. Baum ordered the Enigma machine removed and sent topside, unaware that he had just made one of the most important intelligence seizures of the war.
And I said, "Yes, it looks interesting." We both thought it was. So I said, "Unscrew it and send it up." And he had a very bright chap. He had a screwdriver with him, so he just unscrewed it from a wooden table. Four screws, and up it went. Fortunately, it wasn't dropped overboard.
6 hours had passed since Baum had boarded the U-110. The convoy had long since moved on, and now the Bulldog was called away by a submarine alert. Satisfied that no scuttling charges had been set, Baum and his men were left alone aboard the enemy submarine, bobbing precariously in the middle of the endless Atlantic.
And that was a very nasty moment. I was there with my boarding party of about eight of us, standing up on deck, nothing in sight at all. Grey skies, mist, wind getting up, and nothing in sight. One only prayed that the Bulldog would find us again in the middle of the Atlantic.
The Bulldog returned a few hours later and placed the once mighty U-110 under tow. The course was set for a British naval base in Iceland, but the Atlantic, unpredictable to the end, rose to reclaim the boat that had once prowled her cold, dark depths.
The gale got up, and then at 11 o'clock, on the 10th, the day after, she suddenly went down. Her bows came right up. She went down, went and slipped her toe, and she sank.
And so, with all of her precious secrets captured by the British and her imprisoned crew completely unaware of the loss, the U-110's grey frame slipped beneath the waters of the Atlantic for the last time. Soon after seizing the German submarine U-110 in the North Atlantic in the spring of 1941, British naval officer David Baum realized that the capture was important. But he didn't know how important until more than a week after the dramatic battle at sea.
We eventually fetched up in Scarpa Flow, the big naval base in Scotland. The Admiralty sent up an intelligence officer, their top intelligence officer, and he told me as soon as he saw it, he said, "This is amazing. We've never had anything like this. We've been looking for this for a whole war."
Enigma had been solved, the code machine and settings found. Combined with documents seized from two German weatherships off Greenland, the British now had detailed information on Wolfpack formations, weather reports and convoy sightings. And with code books that gave rotor settings until the end of June, the cryptographers at Bletchley Park finally had the tools to crack the seemingly unbreakable enigma.
And they were able, for a number of months, to read the German Navy enigma messages just the same way as the German code clerks were able to do.
The fortunes of war had shifted, this time in favor of the British. And knowing that for perhaps the first time in the Battle of the Atlantic, the advantage was suddenly theirs, the British took drastic steps to ensure that their dramatic capture would remain secret. They reported the U-110 lost at sea with all hands aboard. The German sailors were secretly shuttled to prisoner of war camps in North America.
"We boarded a ship in Liverpool, which traveled to Canada and landed on January 1st, 1942 in Halifax. We spent 3 days on the train, after which we reached the prison camp 23. This camp was somewhere south of the Hudson Bay."
With Hoegel and the rest of the U-110's crew at the prisoner of war camp in Canada, somehow the seizing of the Enigma machine was kept under wraps.
And what's really interesting is that they were able to keep it such a secret for so long. All the sailors involved in the incident kept quiet about it. And this is really an amazing feat.
Wonderful people, the sailors. They all told the absolute dead secret. And nobody ever breathed a word. And nobody ever knew that we'd boarded U-110.
Armed with the information from the Enigma capture, the British diverted many of their convoys out of harm's way and began to wrest control of the Atlantic back from the Germans. The British were immediately able to change the course of their ships and, ultimately, the course of the war. Dönitz and the rest of the Nazi high command couldn't understand why convoys weren't showing up where they were supposed to be, and why their vaunted U-boats were suddenly being sunk by British destroyers marauding the high seas in hunter-killer groups.
"It cannot depend on chance. It is possible that from some source or other, their information might be gained, A, as a result of treachery, B, by decrypting our radio messages, which is out of the question."
The Germans were convinced that the Navy version of Enigma was unbreakable, that the DLIs could never break into it. So therefore, when problems began to develop with the U-boat fleets and the British began to sink U-boats, they never suspected that the British had broken into the Enigma codes. They thought that it was espionage.
If these guys had said, "No, the Enigma is breakable," they would have had to have said to themselves, "All my work is useless." They would have had to have gone to Dönitz and say, "Hey, we screwed up." And they would have had to have gone to Hitler and say, "Hey, we are responsible for the loss of the Battle of the Atlantic." This is not something that they were eager to do. So I think there were a number of psychological reasons why they never actually searched hard enough to find out that their system may well have been broken.
The Nazis were desperate to regain their tactical edge and unwilling to admit the possibility that the mighty Enigma had been compromised. they launched exhaustive investigations into possible explanations for their losses. After all of the plausible explanations were explored and rejected, their theories became more and more far-fetched. They were even suspicious that German U-boat officers enjoying the scandalous nightlife of Paris might be compromising the secrecy of their operation. So Dönitz's staff opened a counter-espionage investigation of one Parisian nightclub, the Scheherazade. Here, beautiful French waitresses who spoke German were thought to be doubling as military spies. It was arrogance that prevented the Germans from accepting the possibility that the Enigma had been breached, and discouragement caused Dönitz to look closely at his own staff.
When they could not find any spies after a complete search of U-boat headquarters and all the ancillary operations, Dönitz turned to his second command and says, "It's got to be either you or me."
But no leak was ever found. And by late 1943, the specter of Dönitz's grey wolves no longer cast a forbidding shadow on the waters of the Atlantic. Hitler's decision to launch a second front against Russia drained resources and left the naval forces vulnerable and overextended. Dönitz pleaded for greater U-boat production, but Providence, it seemed, had already moved against him. When American forces, after long delays, finally lent air support to convoys steaming across the Atlantic, the Wolfpacks were forced into defensive maneuvering. They stayed submerged to survive, and their attacks became more and more isolated. The hunter had become the hunted. To make matters worse, Dönitz's elite U-boat crews had been decimated by losses.
The ratio of deaths in the U-boat command was higher than in any other service, including fighting in the snows and the winters of Russia. Something like 2 out of 3 men who were in the U-boat command didn't come back.
The command that had once been composed of proud and expertly trained volunteers, the best of the best, now had to draft men who were barely ready to fight. Word had got out about the dirty, dangerous, often fatal reality of life aboard a submarine. The glory days of the invincible grey wolves of the Kriegsmarine were long gone.
In the submarine war, there had been plenty of setbacks and crises. Such things are unavoidable in any form of warfare. But we had always overcome them because the fighting efficiency of the U-boat arm had remained steady. Now, however, the situation had changed. We had lost the Battle of the Atlantic.
By this time, Dönitz's superior officer, Grand Admiral Erich Raeder, had been sacked by Hitler. Dönitz's long loyalty to the Führer was rewarded with a promotion to Raeder's old job.
Dönitz was one of Hitler's most ardent supporters in the German military. A lot of the officers were not political. Dönitz was very political. He was very close to Hitler. He admired him.
But even the faithful, the true believers like Dönitz, could see that the end of the formidable Nazi regime was near. By the beginning of 1945, Germany was besieged by opponents on all sides, with the Allies closing in from the west and the Russians relentlessly advancing from the east. As the end approached, Hitler's high command scattered to the winds. Reichsmarschall Göring was captured by the Allies. Heinrich Himmler, chief of the SS, had committed the high treason of surrender. Hitler turned to Dönitz, his trusted warrior, and bestowed upon him a final award for loyalty, the leadership of Nazi Germany. The day of Hitler's suicide, Dönitz was named the new chief of the Third Reich, but his reign was short-lived. He presided over the crumbling of the Nazi Empire. And on May the 7th, 1945, Dönitz completed his final act as a warrior. He surrendered to the Allied forces. Tried with Göring, Speer, and the rest of the notorious Nazi Ten at the Nuremberg War Crimes Tribunal, Dönitz received a punishment of 10 years in prison.
After Dönitz gets out of prison in the 50s, he releases his memoirs. And this work is really Dönitz's way of saying, what if only I had 300 U-boats at the beginning of the war, if only I had been able to coordinate Wolfpack, if only.
certain departments of the German Navy, and the leaders of the German state also failed to appreciate the importance of the U-boat arm. That is the tragedy of the German U-boats in the Second World War.
Dönitz wanted to build 300 U-boats, and had there been 300 U-boats in service at the start of the war would have taken a very different course. It's very questionable whether Great Britain would have been able to survive at that time.
But Dönitz had lost the political battle for more boats. And with the capture of the U-110 and the Enigma's secrets, he'd lost the Battle of the Atlantic. In so doing, he had perhaps lost the war itself.
In World War II, control of the sea was a very important factor in the Allied victory. Without control of the sea, the Allies could not have won the war. Naval wars are sometimes told in the terms of Midways and Trafalgar, but the capture of U-110 is as important as any of those.
Years after his release from a Canadian prisoner of war camp, U-110 radio officer Georg Hogel still thought about his fallen commander, Fritz Julius Lemp.
The worst that happened to us was after we were rescued. We always hoped that they would find him somewhere. We all suffered a lot when we realized that he was not among us. And this pain remains even today, because if the captain had survived, our relationship would have been such that we would have met many times.
While Hogel was unaware of the consequences of his U-110's capture, British Navy Sub-Lieutenant David Barr knew he had played a starring role in one of the most critical struggles of the Second World War.
By capturing Enigma, we saved the war from being lost that summer, because we would have lost the war that summer. The losses were too great.
The Allies had suffered much, but they'd realized their objective. They'd conquered Germany's U-boat division and prevailed in the critical battle for the dark waters of the Atlantic. They had finally brought the Nazi Empire to its knees. It's been said by some that the sea holds her secrets tight and takes them jealously to her silent depths. But sometimes she yields her secrets in the most unexpected of ways, offering them up as a reward to those she deems heroic in battle and worthy in their cause.
Everything, in a certain sense, depended on victory in the Battle of the Atlantic.
2 years into hostilities with the Germans, the British position in the Battle of the Atlantic seemed hopeless. The Germans were destroying up to 800,000 tons of shipping per month, sinking ships faster than the British and Americans could build them. Britain's lifeline was in grave danger of being choked off. Her leaders were secretly worried that defeat was at hand. Winston Churchill himself had dark fears that the mighty German Navy would sound the death knell for Great Britain.
Churchill believed that the Battle of the Atlantic was one of the most important parts of Britain's efforts in World War II. He said he was frightened sometime by the number of sinkings and wondered how long Britain could continue into the war.
The Atlantic is home to countless fierce predators, but perhaps none were as ferocious as Germany's dreaded fleet of U-boats. These sleek steel death machines of the open ocean were known as grey wolves. British Sub-Lieutenant David Baum had encountered grey wolves soon after enlisting in the Royal Navy.
In September 39, I was in a destroyer called the Ivanhoe, one of two destroyers escorting the aircraft carrier Courageous when she was torpedoed and sunk. It was very dramatic, one of the very first actions of the whole war at sea, only 10 days after the war had begun. A big loss of life. Frightful.
The chief architect of Germany's stranglehold on the Atlantic was Admiral Karl Dönitz. As a former submarine commander himself, Dönitz understood the special qualities required of the men who lived their lives gliding silently beneath the waves in these so-called iron coffins. His memoirs reflect his commitment to the war below the surface.
Every submariner, I am sure, has experienced in his heart the glow of the open sea, has felt himself to be as rich as a king, and for change places with no man.
Georg Hogel met Admiral Dönitz as a young sailor in the U-boat command.
Dönitz is to all Zeiten respektiert worden. Vielleicht klingt das jetzt ein bisschen.
Dönitz had always been respected. This might sound a bit sentimental, but the old generation of U-boat sailors have always considered him the father of the U-boat sailors. Dönitz had always had our respect, and this was also true for foreign admirals and generals, who also said he was an excellent leader of his men.
Führer seiner Leute war.
After fighting in World War I, Dönitz studied submarine warfare with single-minded devotion. He extended the same devotion to the men of his Kriegsmarine, becoming a one-man welcoming crew as they returned from training exercises and missions. Short in stature, but a giant to his men, Dönitz was tireless and dedicated to a fault, determined to refine and perfect the merciless German U-boat strategy known as Wolfpack. Britain's fate rose and fell in the most capricious and uncertain of places, the rolling waters of the open ocean. The men of Germany's U-boat fleet roamed the high seas unhindered during the early days of World War II. Their stealth made them a frustratingly elusive target for enemy ships. The U-boats were deadly instruments of power and brought both misery and glory to those who served aboard them. Georg Hogel joined the German Navy in 1937 at the age of 18 and became a U-boat radio operator the following year. He was one of the select young men in Dönitz U-boat service.
Die Begeisterung für die U-Boot-Waffe, wie gesagt, das war natürlich.
The enthusiasm for the U-boats, so to speak, came from a young man's desire to be in a service to which we attributed danger and a certain prestige. We wanted to become men, and therefore we wanted to join a service which was considered to be one of the toughest.
The unprecedented success of the U-boat crews made them heroes at home. Nazi Minister of Propaganda Joseph Goebbels lionized the most noted U-boat aces and dubbed them the Grey Wolves. Adolf Hitler himself handed out iron crosses to the most decorated of U-boat skippers.
When we returned home, there was an orchestra at the pier. There were officers, other crews, and maybe even a few young ladies. As sailors on a U-boat, we were maybe aware that we were using one of the most dangerous weapons and that our fight in the Atlantic was necessary to cut the English trade.
With their white peaked caps and astonishing tales of seafaring victories and derring do, these elite young officers and their men were given the privileges of royalty. The best of everything was theirs for the taking.
They were issued the highest medals, they got the best pay, they got the best food. There were films made about them, they were treated as heroes.
We had excellent food, and you might laugh about this, but we always had porcelain on board. The only time we had to eat from a tin plate was when we returned home and there was no more unbroken porcelain available.
Dönitz's emphasis on making heroes of the U-boat aces may have been in part an ingenious strategy to offset the reality of the most arduous and deadly job in the German military.
The U-boat was almost unlivable by the standards of civilians. It was crowded, it was dirty. There was one head for all 47 men.
The way the Wolfpack strategy worked was as follows. One submarine would spot a convoy and would radio back to headquarters in Germany or occupied France the location of this convoy.
No longer would submarines operate alone and isolated in the vast ocean. Dönitz's men glided beneath the waves until they located the enemy, then waited for reinforcements. When darkness fell over the water, they attacked in a swarm, striking quickly and without pity.
Torpedo!
To Dönitz, Wolfpack tactics seemed as much instinct as they did carefully orchestrated strategy.
One of our most natural instincts is the desire, if fight we must, to be as strong as possible, not to be left to fight alone, but to seek the help of others. From time immemorial, therefore, men have always banded themselves together to fight in unison.
The wolf packs ran free at the beginning of the war. The pickings in the Atlantic were so easy that the German skippers even gave the era a jaunty nickname.
The Germans called the heyday of the U-boats in 1940 the happy time. They had a field day during this period.
Dönitz and his grey wolves were masters of the seas. Great Britain was bruised, bloodied, and reeling from the German onslaught. Even America's shores weren't immune from the U-boat menace. Heavy shipping losses along the eastern seaboard from U-boat attacks led to near panic. Naval and private vessels alike patrolled the waters, searching for the dreaded Nazi submarines. Dönitz controlled everything from his lavish headquarters in occupied France, issuing a steady stream of instructions and orders to his trusted warriors beneath the waves. For the reign of the Grey Wolves depended on constant communication with Dönitz.
All orders bringing the U-boats together were issued from his headquarters by radio communications. The U-boats constantly reported back their positions, their usages of torpedoes, their fuel, and so forth. And, of course, this created a lot of communications material for the British to lock in on if they managed to break it.
But Dönitz was convinced the Allies could never break his codes because he had a secret weapon, the Enigma machine. Almost all wartime communication on both the Allied and Axis sides was encrypted. But the Enigma was among the most sophisticated of all encryption machines. It was capable of millions of variations and considered unbreakable by the German high command. Using messages kept secret by Enigma, Dönitz could dispatch U-boats to surround British convoys. The British had their top codebreakers working around the clock at an English country estate called Bletchley Park to plumb its secrets. If they didn't solve the riddle of the Enigma, they knew the war might be lost.
Churchill looked at a chart at the Admiralty, watching the line of sinkings rising on the wall to a red line which they had drawn across the top, which meant that Britain could not continue the war, and it was rapidly approaching that line.
As the curtain closed on 1940,
and officers and men, it was almost always in use. You couldn't use it when the boat was submerged.
Then, for the ersten Fahrt, man konnte sich.
During my first trip, we could hardly wash ourselves. We had to beg for cooling water from the diesel engines so we could at least wash our upper bodies. During this trip, we also made coffee with rusty water or salt water. It was really bad.
You're underwater. You don't get any fresh air. There's water all over dripping down on the side from the condensation. So it's wet, it's clammy, it's damp. You're never dry. You can't take a shower. I mean, it's like a super locker room. There are salamis and other things hanging around. You're always with the same guy, the same songs are being played, there's nothing to do. When U-boat ships came back into port and the land crew opened up the front hatches to let the men out, the stench was so bad that they stepped back.
It took a seaman with a singular dedication and audacity to withstand such grueling conditions and to descend time and again in the iron coffins, from which two out of every three sailors never returned.
I
was always aware of the fact that this boat could be my coffin. I often told some of my comrades in critical situations that it doesn't make any sense to run from one end of the boat to the other. If a torpedo explodes, you will drown anyway. Death comes so fast, I used to say, that you probably won't feel much. Each voyage was different, and each event showed us that we actually did not know anything, and that there were 100 more ways to lose one's life.
One of the courageous stars of Dönitz's U-boat fleet was 28-year-old Fritz Julius Lemp. Lemp had joined the Navy at the age of 18, and in 10 years' time had become the youngest captain in the history of German submarine warfare. Lemp was cautious but aggressive and unflappable in battle. He was known sometimes to give orders just so his men could hear the calm, confident sound of his voice. Georg Hogel served under Lemp on his first mission on the Type 7 sub U-30.
He was a very friendly captain. He backed up his men as much as he could, even if they made a blunder. As a radio operator, I was constantly next to him. We were separated only by a little hallway and developed a personal relationship. With his permission, during the times when there was nothing going on, which happened frequently, we could play records for the crew. These were little things, but they made life a little more comfortable and contributed to the camaraderie. Nothing could have worked without that.
Lemp had assured his place in history in the opening days of the war between Germany and Britain while skippering the U-30. Waiting for fighting to begin on September the 3rd, 1939, Dönitz had issued strict orders to his U-boat fleet. They were not to attack passenger ships in observance of the regulations passed by the Hague Convention at the turn of the century.
Enemy convoys to be attacked without warning, only on condition that all passenger...
Where you see the passing of time.
The crowds in St. Peter's Square are praying like mad for the Pope's life.
Where moments refuse to die.
This is a momentous hour in world history. This is the invasion of Hitler's Europe.
And where victory lives on.
Plenty of girls are being kissed by plenty of boys they don't know, and they do not care.
You can love it, hate it, embrace it, or turn away.
Lenin was shot to death late last night outside his apartment building.
But it is a past we all share.
Come on out here and give me a salute. Big Navy salute.
This is where yesterday has a home, where we wonder what it was like back then.
Go forward, knights, in safety.
And not too long ago.
His spirit must live on.
It's where history has its place and where the past comes alive. The History Channel.
It's oft been said that he who rules the waves rules the world. That was certainly true for the bloody years of World War II. For had the battles of the Pacific and Atlantic taken another turn, the world we live in might be a very different place indeed. Europe, 1939. The year when the eyes of the world turned towards once defeated Germany in horrified surprise. Under Führer Adolf Hitler, The Third Reich had been secretly rebuilding her armed forces. And now, in a brazen initiation of war, her land forces were effortlessly decimating European armies. On the high seas, her navy, the Kriegsmarine, seemed unstoppable. And no sea was as critical to the war as the Atlantic.
The Battle of the Atlantic was the most important battle of World War II. If you couldn't get supplies over to keep Britain going, we wouldn't have been able to defeat Nazi Germany. We wouldn't have been able to win the war. So every